Today on Typical Books, we're going to be talking about Midwestern Gothic by Scott Thomas. This is a book from Inkshares. Thank you, Noah, for sending this along earlier. And it is coming out right now. I believe it was the 20th or 17th of September. This book was slated to be out earlier, but it's fine to be coming out now because it was going to have a Halloween-y, very fitting of a horror fans horror book release. And this is a really good time to be getting into this. And I couldn't see it being released earlier in the year because it does have those fall vibes. Like, I don't know if the full cover, I haven't looked it up to see if this is the exact released cover, but you know, a field in haying season, it's more fitting of this time of year, I think, than April. So yeah, Midwestern Gothic by Scott Thomas. When this crossed my desk, I was very excited. I really liked Kill Creek, and I know a lot of you did too, because I've seen a lot of people really enjoy it. And there was even jokes around that I should dress up as T.C. Moore for Halloween. Merce from Harpies in the Trees pointed it out. At the time, I had the same haircut and was a little intense, maybe. I still am. And at one time, I did have a terrible eye problem, not quite to T.C. Moore levels, and not for T.C. Moore reasons. If you've read Kill Creek, you know what I'm talking about. I don't have a mohawk anymore, and this is a lot more tempered than the Kill Creek fan service. And that's not an insult by any means. I could see some people thinking that that might be, but I enjoyed every single second of the fan service going on in Kill Creek. I love the cover. I love the deckled edges. I love the characters. I love that it's about writers, and I love that it's writers in sort of an escape room. And then we go kind of, I don't know, in the mouth of madness. And that is a recurring theme in Scott Thomas's writing, I've discovered. So yeah, I was very lucky to get a hold of this, and I read it a little while ago, but I will say that these stories really stick with me. Now, I don't know if it's a trick on behalf of the writer to have written, I don't know, a landmark book with Kill Creek that is a horror book for horror writers and for horror fans. It's in as much as that it's about horror writers that we can identify horror writers we know and love. And sometimes the genders don't really match. Like T.C. Moore, I think of Wrath James White, like in a big way. But those sorts of things being steeped in me as a fan of that book, I come to this and I see some of those familiar names. It's an instant hit because I love that book so much. And you don't have to have read Kill Creek to really enjoy this at all. There's four stories in here. They're all quite different. They have very different tones, but they all take place in the same area, hence the Midwestern Gothic. And the Midwestern Gothic is not entirely a throwback to women screaming running from castles, or women locked in attics of castles going insane, or rich dandies locking women in attics, or whatever your idea of the old Gothic is. And it's not necessarily a modern Gothic like the Mexican Gothic or the Southern Gothic. This is something quite different, and there are points in the stories where I'm wondering, where does this relate to the Gothic? But you know, I'll leave that for you to decide upon reading it. The one thing that we can all decide upon reading it or not is that it does incorporate characters from Kill Creek, which makes it so very exciting. The four stories in this book are The Door in the Field, Where Your Secret Like a Stone, The Boy in the Woods, and One Half of a Child's Face. And I will talk about each of these in turn. I will not spoil the story really at all because, you know, I'd like you to read them, of course. And I typically don't. You know, when I go through a review, a lot of the time I talk about my impressions of the story, and that is what we're going to do. And because there's four very distinct stories, I'm not going to give a lot away. I will say that the first story and the fourth story are tied for my favorites. And it's hard for me to choose a full favorite, but I will say those two stories get 4 stars out of 4 stars. They're perfect. They're wonderful. And I love them. The other two stories, it's not that I like them less. They just don't like them as much. So they get 3.5 stars. So it's a really like a 4-star book if I'm doing the star thing, which I typically don't. Now, The Door in the Field, it features the author from Kill Creek, Sebastian Cole. Not as a person in the story. And I will say that none of the authors actually make appearances in this book. It's about the authors. We're talking to fans of the authors. We're talking to people who were driven mad by stories like in this one. The Door in the Field is a story or a novella by Sebastian Cole that has sort of driven somebody mad, much like a King in Yellow or a Necronomicon, that sort of story. It has done something to this family. And this man who is on a job site and gets into like a bad reaction, bad entanglement with his boss, maybe a fight. Maybe he used to fight too much and now he's trying to take a chill pill. He reminds me very much of like a Stephen King character, someone who came from a rough and tumble past trying to set things straight. It also reminds me of a Stephen Graham Jones character. I believe it's a Stephen Graham Jones story about people working on a road crew or a chain gang and they discover the resting place of something or someone and disturb it. Very similar to that. There is a lot of family history being disturbed and a lot of madness that is being found in the door in the field. And this story by Sebastian Cole plays a big part of this story. And I really love that. It's like one big long library scene and having something kind of Lovecraftian, like a story that comes and drives people mad. That's sort of the subplot of this story with another story on top of it that features some really compelling characters. Wear Your Secret Like a Stone is the second story, and it's so close to being in my top two as well, because I mean they all can't just be perfect. Like I can't, oh maybe I can like them all equally. I don't know, I'm sure the author likes them all equally. That's why we're blessed with them in this book. But Wear Your Secret Like a Stone, the fictional author's fictional work that is featured in this story is T.C. Moore. And this story is really topical, and I really like this more modern story. Not that the tales here all take place in the old-timey days. They're all modern, but this one deals with younger people and problems of cancellation or being shouted down because of some horror things that you like. And that's something that maybe horror fans have dealt with, so it really spoke to me. Because it's a young girl working in a box store that has to deal with her taste in horror being shouted down by the vox populi. Or maybe, not the vox populi, maybe just one crazy lady that lives on the edge of town. And because this author is T.C. Moore, the author that this girl likes, I really have an affinity for that because I kind of like T.C. Moore and I would probably read her work and I would probably champion her work like this young girl does. The Boy in the Woods is the third story in this book and it takes place at Camp Cottonwood and it is a camp slasher. So it will really fill that void. You know, if you are looking forward to reading the book that I just talked about, what was it? Heads Will Roll by Josh Winning. Yeah. Camp slashers. This is another sort of camp slasher, and it deals with young Eddie as our Jason Voorhees type person, but we get to know him a lot better and spend a lot more time with him. He's a more full-fledged character, and he's not Jason Voorhees at all. He's Eddie, and he is treated like a freak. It's a story about bullying, and it does have a twist. So I really enjoyed this story. It is not up there. It's tied for second place with the story I just talked about, Wear Your Secret Like a Stone. It does have a crazy Ralph, just like Friday the 13th, and I really like that. And it is Daniel Slaughter, the author, that is talked about. And this tracks because Daniel Slaughter is sort of our R.L. Stine type person in Kill Creek. He writes for a younger audience. He writes kind of campy, splattery little tales that are spooky goosebumpsy things. He doesn't write like serious as a heart attack hardcore horror like T.C. Moore. He doesn't write these like highfalutin literary gothic tales like Sebastian Cole. He doesn't write the boilerplate airplane novel rack 400 prolific novels per year Sam McGarver stuff. He writes for kids, and he's like sort of a frumpy old monster kid at that. So yeah, really fits that a young dude being bullied at a summer camp will read Daniel Slaughter. And tied for favorite is the final story, and it is about a girl who is writing. It starts out as a dissertation, but it's a book talking about the worlds of Sam McGarver. And this would be a lot like someone writing about Stephen King. This character would be the sort of person writing the ultimate biography on this author, Sam McGarver. So again, the author from Kill Creek isn't featured in the story, but their work is. And they are talking about this story that they're writing called Midwestern Gothic, about the gothic world that Sam McGarver has created in his fictional books. And I only wish that we could read them. And I also wish that we could read Sutter Kane, because this takes a turn into almost like a Clive Barker In the Mouths of Madness sort of world. And it is kind of coupled with Rear Window, because she has had a very tumultuous life the past little while. And she has a rear window view of her ex and his new family. And that isn't the horror. What she's seeing is definitely tainted by otherworldly presences. And I absolutely love her. You know, she is a reliable narrator. Heck, she is narrating a book about an author that writes horror like this. So you would think, okay, it's my bias, maybe, thinking that she's an unreliable narrator. But we do have that Rosemary's Baby bit where other people are treating her like maybe she needs to rest, you know? Very gothic in that nature. So yes, that is my number one favorite story. And I really tie it for the first story, because I love the premise of the first story and the mechanics used in it by having a story that has driven somebody crazy. And this is kind of the mirror image of that, where the story is keeping them sane. And I really loved every story in this. If you haven't already, pick up Midwestern Gothic. If you're a big fan of Kill Creek, this is really goes hands in hand with it. And the last story, One Half of a Child's Face, sort of works not as a sequel, but a follow-up to Kill Creek, because the events of Kill Creek are front and center at the beginning of that story. So yes, if you're a fan and you want a completion, if you're looking for a follow-up to Kill Creek, I know I am, then this really does work. And it's wonderful to hang out with fans of these fictional authors I'm now a fan of. I've not read Violet by Scott Thomas, and that is a book that I've heard really good reviews about. If you've read Scott Thomas that I haven't, let me know in the comments below, or if you are also a Scott Thomas fan, or alternatively, if you didn't like either of those books, Kill Creek or any other, let me know, because I'm curious to hear. Maybe that rubbed somebody the wrong way, having a horror book about horror authors for horror people. Maybe it was pandering, but I didn't take it that way, and I loved every minute of it, and I really liked revisiting them. So yeah, if you pick it up and give it a read, let me know in the comments what you thought. Thank you so much for watching, and have an ooky spooky day.